Good day, and welcome back to TMac FPV, your home for your journey to better FPV fun, flights, and racing stuff. This is episode 2 of our FPV Boot Camp, designed to help you get started with FPV the right way and make a well-informed decision as to what FPV gear is best for you so you can save both time and money and have more fun sooner. If you missed episode 1, How Quads Fly, go ahead and check it out at the card up above or through the link in the video description below. At the end of this short FPV Boot Camp series, we'll be giving away one free enrollment to our Fast Track FPV course, which goes into much more detail of not only these topics, but everything you need to know to get started in this FPV hobby, to include a coupon code which can be used multiple times for a big discount on gear purchases for the remainder of 2019. To qualify for the giveaway, either for yourself or someone you know, make sure to check out the rules in the description below. Last time we covered how quads fly, this time we're going to take a look at what makes quads fly. We'll do that with a general overview of their main components. With a better understanding of the different parts of your quad, you'll eventually be able to create your own custom build and also troubleshoot any issues which may come up due to, shall we say, unintentional durability tests. Let's get started. There are 7 main components which we'll go over, and the first one we want to take a look at is the quadcopter's frame. The purpose of the frame is to house and protect all the other quadcopter's components. It's usually made up of carbon fiber because that material is both strong and lightweight. For an FPV quadcopter to perform well, ideally you want to have a large thrust-to-weight ratio, which just means you'd like your quad to be lightweight with a lot of power from your motors. So the lighter your frame, the better. However, if you go too lightweight with carbon fiber material that is too thin to effectively withstand the weight of the other components, the frame itself may break when involved in a crash. Usually for smaller quads, or micro quads, which spin 2 to 4 inch props, the bottom plate and arms of the frame are 2 to 3 millimeters thick. For larger quads or mini quads which spin 5-inch props and also tend to be much heavier, the frames are usually at least 4 millimeters thick. The length of the arms on your frame, or more precisely the distance the end of the arm is from the rest of the frame, will determine the size of the props your quad can spin. There's different frame styles for different types of flying which are depicted here. Normal X frames are in the shape of an X and have the distance from motor to motor in the front the same as motor to motor in the rear. These true X frames are usually good for both freestyle and racing. Stretch X frames, like this one, have a narrower distance between the arms side to side than they do front to back. These are usually better for racing than freestyle. Then you have hybrid frames like this, in which the distance between the front arms may be narrower than the distance between the motors in the back. You also have H frames, which are in the shape of an H. One advantage to this type of frame is there are no props in view of your camera while you're flying. These are good for cinematic videography. The type of hole pattern at the end of your quad's arms will determine the size of motors you can install. Some micro quads have a 9mm hole mounting pattern, whereas some have 12mm mounting patterns, and mini quads spinning 5-inch props can have 16mm mounting patterns. For more information on frames, check out my video on micro FPV quadcopter parts, 3-inch frames, in the playlist at the card up above or through the link below. The second component we'll look at is the electronic speed controller, or ESC for short. Although quads can have separate ESCs for each motor, the type we're going to look at is called a 4-in-1 ESC, which has all 4 ESCs on one board. The main function of the ESC is to tell your motors how fast to spin based on instructions from your flight controller, which are directed per your transmitter control stick inputs. Consequently, all 4 motors of your quadcopter are physically connected to the ESC, usually through solder joints. Your power source, or LiPo for your quad, is also usually connected to the ESC. ESCs are rated based on the amount of current they can provide your motors both continuously and in bursts, so you're going to need to get an ESC which is rated appropriately for the type and size motors you're going to be using on your quad. If you get an ESC with an insufficient rating for your motors, your ESC will overheat, fail, and at times emit the magic smoke, which means you're going to be grounded until you're able to replace it. Next, we'll take a look at your quad's motors. There are many different size and types of motors you can choose from. In general, the larger the motor, the heavier it is, and the more power or thrust it has. Motor sizes are usually described in terms of 4 numbers. The first 2 numbers represent the width of the motor, or the stator diameter, and the last 2 numbers describe the height of the motor, the stator height. Both of these dimensions are in millimeters. There are numerous factors to consider when choosing motors for your quad, and I could do an entire video just on motors. In fact, I have. For more specific details on motor parameters, check out the video at the card up above, or in the video description below. The fourth component we'll look at is the brain of your quad, or the flight controller. It contains the microcontroller and the microprocessing unit, or the MPU, to include the accelerometer and gyroscope, or the gyro. It also includes certain types of interfaces which allow you to connect other devices to it.
These interfaces are called UARTs, which is short for Universal Asynchronous Receiver Transmitter.
Your flight controller is connected to your ESC so it can send information to it, which allows the ESC to control the speed of your motors. There are a ton of different types of flight controllers out there with different features for different types of builds. I go over these features more in depth in my Flight Controllers and ESCs video, available up above or in the link below. The two flight control stacks I compare in that video I still use today for most of my builds because they've proven to be both effective and reliable.
The next part we'll look at is our receiver. The receiver gets your commands from your transmitter control inputs and passes those signals onto the flight controller. So it's important that your receiver and transmitter speak the same language or protocol. That seems obvious, but the reasons I bring it up is different brand transmitters and receivers have different protocols, and sometimes even within the same company's brand, their transmitters and receivers use different protocols. Some transmitters are able to communicate with most types of receivers through the use of a multi-protocol module, either internally installed or through an external connection in a module bay. The Jumper T16 is a good example of that type of transmitter. Usually the communication between transmitter and receiver is done at the 2.4 GHz frequency band, but you can also get receivers and external modules which work with them that operate at the 900 MHz frequency band, such as the TBS Crossfire or the FRSky R9M systems. I've got a video on using 900 MHz which you can check out above or at the link below. With the 900 MHz band, you can fly farther and through and around objects without losing your control signal, more so than you could when using the 2.4 GHz band. Just make sure before you purchase a transmitter and a receiver, you know which protocol you want to use.
Your FPV camera is the next part we'll take a look at. It's basically your eyes in flight. The view of your FPV camera is the same view you're going to have in your goggles. So if your FPV camera has a 120-degree field of view, so will you. If it has a 160-degree field of view, you will also. FPV cameras come in different physical sizes. Some are 22 millimeters, some are 19 millimeters, and some are 14 millimeters. You'll want to make sure that the FPV camera you choose fits the camera mount of your frame. The aspect ratio of the video your FPV camera captures is something else to consider. Your options here are 16:9 and 4:3. Some cameras are switchable between the two aspect ratios and some are not. What's important to remember here is the aspect ratio of your camera should match that of your FPV goggles, since some goggles are switchable between the two aspect ratios and some are not. There are many different brands of FPV cameras on the market to choose from. Picture quality, reliability, cost, and latency, or the amount of delay you encounter with the image processing, are important parameters to consider when choosing an FPV camera. The final component we'll take a look at is the video transmitter, or the VTX. The main function of the video transmitter is to do just that, transmit the video back to your goggles. The most commonly used VTXs transmit in the 5.8 GHz range on 5 bands and 8 channels within each band. The precision at which the VTX operates at your desired channel, along with its power output options and physical size and weight, are important parameters to consider, along with cost, of course. Some VTXs have more capabilities than others, and parameters which I consider to be important are covered in various VTX review videos within the Micro FPV Drone Parts playlist mentioned earlier.
Now you have a basic understanding of the main parts of an FPV quad and what they do. This should help guide you in making well-informed decisions for not only what components to buy for your own build, but also troubleshooting things as they come up. And they will. That's just part of the hobby. Remember to check out the rules for the Fast Track FPV enrollment giveaway in the description below. Like the video and share it with your friends. Subscribe and click on that bell below to get notified of future videos. Thank you for your time. We'll see you next video. Clear skies, friend.